Many engineering teams use staging to test new features before releasing them to production. Testing is certainly useful, but is testing on staging really the best way to do it? Let's find out. Hi, I'm Denis, and I'm CTO at IBM. On this channel, we explore modern ways to build better software faster. If you are interested in these topics, please subscribe. There will be more videos like this. Today, we're talking about staging. We'll explore how staging fits development workflows, its pros and cons, and whether we actually need it. Staging is a bit of a controversial topic among developers. Some people would argue that it's absolutely essential, others that it's not needed. And even the term staging may be ambiguous. Different people mean different things. Let's first define what we will call staging in this video, and then talk about its usage patterns. Let's look at all the environments where our app can be deployed. First, there is production. Most web apps have only one production environment, but some have many, in particular apps that customers can install on premises in their network. Next, there are development environments, where the engineers write and debug code. Each developer has its own development environment so that they do not interfere with each other. It can be on their machine or in the cloud. Now, there could be a third type of environment, staging, somewhere between development and production. After completing a feature, developers deploy it on staging for testing and review, and wait for a green light to release it to production. This is what we'd call staging, a separate environment that people use to test new features and approve them for production release. If there is no separate environment, for example, features are reviewed in the development environment or in production, we assume there is no staging. If there is a separate environment, but it's not used for approvals, again, we assume there is no staging. Imagine a developer who wanted to test some infrastructure change and deployed a separate environment for testing. If they only tested themselves and are not waiting for anyone else's approval, we assume it's not staging, since there is no approval process. Now, let's see where staging fits in the code workflows. We have the main branch, which corresponds to production. If we have staging, there should be a staging branch as well. Ideally, both branches should have CI pipelines configured for automated deployments to production and staging. When a developer starts working on a new feature, they create a new feature branch from main. When the feature is ready for review, they merge this feature branch into staging, and it gets deployed to staging. The review process may take a while, maybe a few days. So, they're going to work on something else in the meantime. They pick their next task, create another feature branch, and, who knows, maybe manage to complete yet another feature and merge it to staging while the first one is still in review. And the same happens to all developers on the team. As a result, we have multiple features on staging in different phases of the review process. Some features are still pending review. For others, we have feedback and they require more work. And some features are considered ready. We have a green light to push them to production. In theory, we could wait until all features of staging are ready and then release them all at once. But that would slow down development significantly. At some point, we'll have to announce a code freeze, not allowing any new features on staging, and waiting until all known issues are resolved. While some companies are doing this, such an approach isn't widespread in web development, and for good reasons. Most companies prefer small and frequent production updates because they are faster and more reliable. If something goes wrong, it's much easier to understand why and fix it. We'll be looking at this option when features are released one by one as soon as they are ready. When a feature is considered ready, the developer merges its branch into main, and it gets deployed to production. Now, see what happens. We tested this feature on staging together with other features that were also on staging at that time. But we didn't test it in isolation. We didn't test this particular system version where only this change is applied to production. If all features were completely independent, it shouldn't be a problem. But in reality, dependencies do happen sometimes. So we spent time testing this feature on staging and then deployed a slightly different version of the app to production, not exactly the same one we tested, which undermines the reliability of such testing. To solve this problem, people invented dedicated feature environments, that are automatically created for each feature branch. When a developer opens a pull request, an automation script configures a new dedicated test environment with a separate URL for testing. All subsequent updates to this pull request will be automatically deployed to its dedicated environment. After the pull request is closed, a script shuts down the environment and frees resources. This option is more complex than a single staging environment. It also requires more resources because multiple test environments are now running simultaneously. However, the code workflow becomes simpler. We no longer need a dedicated staging branch where the code must be merged for demonstration purposes, which means fewer merge conflicts. And we now test each feature individually and not in combination with other features, meaning we test what happens if only this change is applied to production. That sounds like progress. But not all problems are solved. Remember, feature development and the review process take time. It could be a few days or maybe even weeks. During this time, other features and bug fixes may land on the main branch, making this feature branch a bit outdated. The longer the feature branch exists, the bigger this gap will be. As a result, we are testing the new feature on an outdated app version, which is not the same one currently running in production. Of course, it's possible to rebase the feature branch from main and retest everything. But this is extra work, and it could be very hard to catch up with an actively developed project where the main branch gets multiple updates daily. As a result, we are in the same situation again, deploying into production an app version that is slightly different from the one we tested. Another big problem with staging is related to the testing data. Staging is a separate, isolated environment with its own database, so the data on staging is different from production. On one hand, this is good because we can experiment with it without fear of breaking something. On the other hand, some bugs in the app reveal themselves only when certain data combinations are used. The amount of data also matters for performance reasons. What works well on small datasets may become painfully slow in production with millions of records, and we should test for that before putting a feature in production. Finally, testing with real data matters from the usability perspective. An interface that looks great on designer mockups may look not so great with real data. Testing with real data has numerous benefits. So, how do we ship real production data to staging? If we want staging to be a more or less accurate representation of production, we should update its database from production regularly. It doesn't seem too complicated, does it? We can simply add a cron job that takes the most recent production backup and restores it on staging. Well, the first thing we'll need to care of is database migrations. Some of the features already deployed on staging might require changes to the database. If we simply override the database with the production backup, these features will break, so after restoring the backup, we'll also need to reapply the database migrations. Now, how long will it take to restore the backup? We are lucky if the production database is small and can be restored in a few minutes. But what if its size is in terabytes and the restoration process takes many hours? Staging will be unusable while it's running. And what if we're creating a dedicated feature environment for each pull request and the production backup is so large? Are we going to launch a powerful server for each pull request and wait many hours before we can even start testing a new feature? We can probably mitigate it to some degree with clever engineering solutions and a lot of computing power. But please note what's going on. We are putting in more and more effort and resources trying to bring the staging environment closer to production. And it's never perfect. Even if we solve all problems with testing data and automate all the things, the main branch will continue running forward quickly with feature branches lagging behind it. So we will still be testing not exactly the same app version that eventually goes into production. Fortunately, there is a better way. Nothing is as close to production as production itself. What if, instead of investing in increasingly sophisticated staging, we try to organize a safe way of testing in production? It turns out it's absolutely possible, and even more, the most advanced technology companies are doing exactly this, without breaking things and disturbing end users. They rely on continuous integration and trunk-based development, constantly merging all new work into the main branch, which inevitably results in some unfinished work merged there. However, it's not a problem if we can deploy it without causing any issues for our users. Most options for testing things in production rely on so-called feature flags or feature toggles. This is a simple but very flexible tool that can do a lot. A feature flag is basically an if statement in the code that enables either new or old behavior depending on some condition. In a minute, we'll talk about examples of these conditions. And now I'd like to briefly explain why people are using it and what the benefits are. The main selling point of continuous integration is the reduction of bugs. All work is in the same code branch, and it's always tested together. Instead of testing multiple, slightly different versions of the app, we focus all our testing efforts on one main version, which is also in production. As a result, we can test it better. Feature flags allow us to commit unfinished work to the main branch, but not launch it just yet. It sits under a feature flag and is only visible under specific testing conditions. Any other developer can see this code and experiment with it if they want, even if it's not finished yet. Now, let's discuss the types of conditions that we could use in feature flags. There are many options out there. Here is one for starters. If your team is used to staging, you can emulate staging in production. First, add an additional domain name to the production environment, like staging.theprimaryAppDomain. Next, use a feature flag called staging, which is initialized depending on the domain from which we look at the app. Voila! We can continue saying push to staging or please take a look at staging, but staging is no longer a separate environment. It's just another view of production. Another common option is when new features are activated for selected users or organizations only. It could be called an early access program or experimental features. Sometimes there is a publicly available option to join such a program. And sometimes it's hidden and can be activated by customer support only in their internal admin interface. In any event, we'd end up with a clearly defined subset of users who can see the new features while others can't. It's not always binary. You can either see all experimental features or see none. Browsers are a notable example. In your browser settings, you'll find a lot of feature flags that turn various experimental features on and off. When browser developers assume a feature is already stable enough, they can enable it by default. But even after that, a feature flag could remain to turn it off if it causes problems for someone. Feature flags can also be used to enable a new feature for all users at once. In this case, we call them release flags. This is probably a niche use case, but they could be helpful when we want to have an immediate rollback. Instead of pushing the code that enables or disables the feature, we can do it with a switch somewhere in the admin interface. If we enable the feature for all users and discover that something goes wrong, we can disable it with the push of a button. Feature flags are behind A/B testing and canary deployments. In A/B testing, we enable a new feature for a certain percentage of users and monitor user behavior metrics, trying to understand if they like it or not. In canary deployments, we also enable a feature for a percentage of users, but the purpose is different. In this case, we do a gradual feature rollout, during which we monitor performance metrics to make sure it can adequately handle the production load. As you can see, humanity invented many ways to test new features in production. And many high-tech companies have been successfully using them for a long time. Testing in production isn't just possible, but also very practical and counterintuitively often safer than testing on staging, because we gain better confidence in the features we are going to launch. So, I would argue that most web projects don't need staging. Testing in production may sound scary at first, but it's not so in practice when you understand how it works. It's faster, safer, and more reliable. That being said, there could be situations where staging is necessary. The most obvious is when developers have no access to production. Without production access, there is literally no way to test anything there. All we could do in such situation is organize staging and demonstrate our work there. When I worked on this video, I asked developers from our team to give more examples when staging is necessary, and there were many interesting ideas. However, after we discussed them, we didn't find anything else besides the lack of production access that would require a team to have a staging environment. For example, one of our developers previously worked for Motorola, and he told us that they had a staging that replicated a real mobile network setup built on Motorola hardware. At first glance, it may seem that here staging necessity comes from unique hardware, Motorola processors. It would be very expensive to give all developers such a personal setup, so they organized a shared one. However, remember in the beginning we defined what we would call staging in this video. It's a separate test environment that is used to get approvals for pushing features to production. If developers use the environment for their own testing and do not wait for anyone's approval, this is not staging. The problem with staging is that it breaks development flow, forcing developers not to merge their code into the main branch until the feature passes the review process. If developers are testing themselves whatever they want in whatever environment, it doesn't break the flow, so feel free to test as much as you please. If you can suggest another example where staging is necessary, please write it down in the comments below. That would be very interesting to read. And that's all I have for today. Happy testing!